Hi everyone. Hi, this is Rahul, your Filmi Baniya, and I'm so privileged to introduce to you to our new speaker and this very interesting session which we are doing. And this is a very, very unique interaction with Mr. M.K. Raghavendra. And Mr. M.K. Raghavendra is one of India's foremost movie critics and movie scholars. We have heard a lot about movie producers, writers, directors. We have got guests from US, from Europe, from India on our podcast. And today we're going to get the perspective of what film scholars think about painting issues of the movie industry or the entertainment industry. So one of the major topics now doing around all over social media is why Indian films are not making it to the Oscars. And that's something which we're going to talk to Mr. M.K. Raghavendra about. Like, what is there any academic reason? I mean, it's almost since 1947, we're now looking at 75 years of independence. We don't even have one single India-made in movie which has got a single Oscar. The only person who got an Oscar for his work was Satyajit Ray in 1992, I think, as a Lifetime Achievement Award. Other than that, there are some people working as Indians in international productions or global productions like Slumdog Millionaire or Life of Pi or Water. But otherwise, it has been like a very, very bad run for the Indian film industry, which is apparently the largest movie industry producer of films in the world. So today we're going to talk to Mr. Raghavendra about it, and we have questions from a lot of fans. By the way, Mr. Raghavendra, big warm welcome to the show.
Thank you.
So my first question is from one of our fans, Anshuman Jain. And he says that why do Indian films don't get selected for Oscars? And sir, a little heads up, please speak because you're an extremely learned person. And I would request you to please use simple, lucid language with illustrated examples from Indian films to explain your point of view. And we'll be eternally grateful for that.
Okay, I'll try my best because it's a somewhat not an easy topic. But let's say this, okay?
Okay.
Now, let us look at Indian literature. Okay. Now, the point is storytelling is important in cinema. Now, storytelling would be, shall we say, can be either in literature or in cinema.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Why are Indian writers never even considered for the Nobel Prize for literature? Okay. You could say there is a commonality here between Indian writers not being considered for the Nobel Prize for literature. The only one who won this was Rabindranath Tagore. After that, there's no mention of anyone else.
That was when, I think, maybe...
Long time back, yeah. Similarly, Satyajit Ray is the only person who's got anywhere close to the thing. And it's not only Oscars, okay? It's the issue of accepted on international platforms, right? Now, the point is that at one moment in history, South Korean, Turkish, Iranian, Indian, they were all on par. South American, they were all on par, shall we say 50s or so. I think Mother India also was nominated for some Oscar.
Yes, I forgot, yes.
At that point, they were all together.
Yeah.
And subsequently, Indians have fallen behind. At the same time, consider this important thing, all these commercial cinemas from these countries have fallen. France has fallen, Japan has fallen, Italy has fallen, Germany has, they've all been supplanted and taken over by Hollywood, right? Indian cinema has not been. Okay.
So
Indian cinema survives in India. It's almost impossible to get to for Hollywood to take over Indian cinema in India. Okay.
So can I interrupt
for a minute? Diaspora, right? Now the issue is what it means is that Indians respond to different things from what the West responds to. Okay. Mm-hmm. The same thing which makes your commercial cinema extremely successful on your own turf makes you unacceptable on foreign turf, right?
Fascinating.
So you could say, to draw an analogy, you are making films in DC when the world thing is AC. You get my point? Analogy, right?
But
the point is, what is this difference between AC and DC I'm talking about, between Indian cinema and, say, Western cinema, South Korean cinema, Japanese cinema, Chinese cinema, right? The difference is that Western cinema is based on the notion of mimesis. It sounds like a mimesis. It's basically a thing that the purpose of art, the purpose of literature should be to imitate the world. Okay, observation. Now, when you say imitate the world, whatever is shown in your films, okay, should be some kind of replica of the world, right? Now, the point is, if you look at this, replica of the world means what? It means the world as complex and ambiguous, is complex and ambiguous, is difficult to understand the world. Your film, in similar ways, okay, should include the complexity of the world, right? Now, let us look, Indian cinema, okay, seems to begin with a message of some sort.
Okay.
Okay. Let us expand upon this. Now, let us take this film Parasite. And you answer questions. I'll ask you questions.
Okay.
Parasite. Okay. Now, Parasite, what is that story about?
It's about a dysfunctional family trying to live off another family.
It is about the harami working class. Okay. It's about the harami working class trying to exploit upper class people.
That's okay. A heavy word, MK.
Yes, yes. No, the point is this. Okay. The point is, they are showing working class as a bunch of scheming, plotting people. They may have their reasons, but they are scheming. And look at the way they show it, okay? Doing everything, destroying each other, trying to do, competing with each other, trying to get on in the world, trying to get, become, parasite means what? Parasite is a description of this working class trying to live off the upper class.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now the point is, it is satire. Can you imagine an Indian film where you have a working class versus upper class, where the working class is described as harami?
Well,
is that possible?
Yes, they have done a movie like that.
Which one?
See, Yash Raj Films had produced a movie called Titli, which is.
Oh, I've seen that. No, it's not like that at all. Titli is actually about the bad world, about how people having to get on. It's not really that. I mean, it's not like this at all. I mean, you look at the way, it's a very nasty piece of work, Parasite, and until at the end it does something else. But just look at the way they portray these people, okay?
Okay.
Okay, smelly. I mean, can you imagine these things? The thing is, in Indian cinema, you have a certain accepted conventions that certain people should be represented only in certain ways.
Okay.
The poor have to be noble.
Can I interrupt now, if you don't mind?
Please.
Okay. So, what I have taken from you for last 5 minutes, and I would like to put this out to my audience. I'm going to use a little bit of Hindi as well here. Ki Indian films ke andar ek playbook ko follow karte. They follow a playbook, defined playbook.
Yeah.
And the other thing, what you told us about why the cinemas of Spain, of Italy, of Korea have done well globally on the critical circle or the award circuit is also one of the fact that they are not such big movie industries revenue-wise within their country as they should be. So they are not like box office darlings of their own country.
They're not.
That's one.
But that is not a cause for this. It's a different issue altogether. It's not a cause for their, for their success in the international film festival thing. That's not a cause. I'm just saying that they are doing it in a language which is acceptable internationally. They're making movies which makes them also vulnerable to international productions.
Okay, so what you are saying is they're pandering to a global audience.
I wouldn't use the word pandering. They are speaking a language acceptable globally, which means that global cinema can also enter their space.
Okay.
That way.
And you feel Indian cinema with the kind of content which goes on here doesn't leave much scope for international content and culture to come in.
Yeah, it does not. It does not leave that. It speaks a different language.
Okay.
Okay. Indian cinema speaks a different language. It is not in the same language as an American film or a Japanese film or a South Korean film. Right.
Perfect.
And I said the basic thing is these films are basically observational in their thing, in their, they observe life, they try to imitate life, they try to replicate how, like for example, what's it called, that it's not true that the rich are always bad people and the poor are always good people, in the sense that given the legal circumstances, we know that, that this is not, it's a truism of some sort, in the sense it's a politically correct kind of thing which works in India, but you won't find this... this
political correctness.
Observational thing. what you observe in real life, Indians have a strong sense of what should not be shown. Okay, what should be shown, what should not be shown. Okay,
okay.
It's not only, it's even in popular cinema also. It's a popular cinema and art cinema. Satyajit Ray didn't have this. Satyajit Ray did not have this. Satyajit Ray was trying to be observational, was trying to show people as they were, but that element of complexity was there. But this is true in almost all of art cinema as well as popular cinema. And the reason is, my own understanding of it is, the reason is you believe that truth is independent of experience. It is there in your social text. It is there in your Manusmriti. It is there in your Vedas. It is there in your Upanishads. It is there in the teachings of holy men. And they know more than what the average man sees in everyday life. You get me? What the average man sees in everyday life is ephemeral. It passes. It is not truth. It is just appearance. You get me? So the question is, when you say, like as in Parasite, that a bunch of harami working class types are cheating an upper class person, that is appearance. The truth is that the upper class person, okay, will exploit this. This is the general sense. I mean, look, I'll tell you what happens is, on one side, you've got these religious things like families, religious social things like families, God, as in Hamapke Kon, or that the mother is something, you know, that sort of thing you have in, or that, you know, you take something like Three Idiots. You tell me, let's look at Three Idiots.
Okay.
Gardner's boy, okay, played by Amir Khan, okay, he becomes a genius without any evidence of him studying. Okay, he becomes a great inventor. Why? Genius. Okay, that notion of genius, right? He is a genius, which means he can do anything. Okay, this is a truth, as the way they would see it. But the same character in the film, he goes to a poor man's house and makes fun of that man, holds his nose at the food which is being cooked there, right? His own classmate. So the question is that inconsistency is simply not acceptable. It is not possible. But the question is, since you believe in the notion of genius, that genius who will somehow, you know, or other pass and come brilliantly without doing any studies, okay, that is the truth. Like, you know, why, how does that truth, where does that truth come from? You know, ask me where it comes from. You got to ask me that, right? It comes from the notion that knowledge is within us. Haven't you heard that in college school? Well, knowledge is within us.
Yeah, many times.
But how is knowledge within you? How is, okay, how is the working of a nuclear bomb? How is that knowledge within us? What do you mean exactly by knowledge within us?
I think what you are trying, so what I'm talking about is enlightenment, you know? So there is...
That is not knowledge. See, the question is this, okay, let us understand this. So what happens is, this term will be understood in this way. When you say knowledge within us, whatever it may mean, originally have meant, it is understood that finally, if a person has the means within himself, okay, he can top the class, he can become a genius, he can make inventions without studying, right? That is the way it is understood by the common man, right? So the question is, this entire thing of, you know, your observational thing, that it is necessary to study, it is necessary to work, is forgotten by Three Idiots.
Yes.
There's no way that, for example, that Punsuk Wangdu or what is his name, there's no way they could have come first in class, okay, without studying. It's not possible at all. Gardner's boy, genius or no genius, it's not possible. But the point is, it is accepted by the public because it passes for a truth. Okay, genius, right? So this is the general thing that Indian cinema seems to, your social realist cinema in India, not Ray and not some of the Malayalis or some of them, even people like Mrinal Sen, they have this thing, notion of, you know, of solidarity of the working class, right? Okay. The exploitative nature of the rich. They have these, you know. Yeah, please.
If I can interrupt, you know, I remember when I was in school in 1990s, Mithun Chakraborty used to come in a series of this movies with the title Gareeb. So it will be Gareebon Ka Data, Gareeb, yeah. Gareebon Ka this, that. And, you know, like he made a string of these movies as a labor class. Even there is one of Amitabh Bachchan's top-notch films, which I feel is Kala Pathar, which is again talking about this worksman in the lowest level.
Yeah.
Even Diwar shows this angry young man who comes from the, you know, the lowest forms.
Correct.
Because it is seen that the poor classes in cinema, and I would just like to tell my audiences, मिस्टर राघवेंद्रा जो कहना चाह रहे हैं वो ये बात है कि जो लोअर क्लासेस का पोर्ट्रेयल है हिंदी सिनेमा में, द पोर्ट्रेयल ऑफ द लोअर क्लासेस इन हिंदी सिनेमा,
नॉट ओनली लोअर क्लासेस,
ऑल क्लासेस इन हिंदी सिनेमा इज वेरी डिफाइंड. It's very defined and it
works. All portrayals, let me interrupt, all portrayals in Hindi cinema follow certain locally accepted convention in India. You get me?
Okay.
It is not true to lived experience. They seem to have preconceived notions. Inference precedes observation. Okay. Now the question is, something like Parasite could not have come without a sense of actual social house where people live in society. But here you've got a certain sense. The observation is secondary. Inference, what are right motive, what are right philosophical standpoints, what are right moral issue, moral viewpoints. This is a basic thing. So Indian cinema is very stuck on this, right? On stuck on these things of what should be shown, what should not be shown.
So just to round up our first question, what Anshuman had asked was that we have, you know, basically the idea what Mr. Raghavendra is talking about is that Indian cinema doesn't basically, quote unquote, not exactly cater, but it is made for Indian consumption.
Yes.
Largely. And it's this strategy that jo cinema India mein banta hai, wo India ki consumption ke liye banta hai ya Indian diaspora ke liye banta hai. Is it made for Indian diaspora as well as Indian, you know, audience who are basically looking to it. And that is the reason we tend to not take too many risks when it comes to disturbing this ecological balance, if you might, you know, yeah. As far as content portrayal is concerned. Very good, very nice. And that is the reason we have not been able to get into so many competitions. Because the large idea is that qualitatively, on a global perspective, the quality of content, as well as far as Western perception is concerned, suffers if we tend to follow this playbook.
Yes, okay. You follow this playbook.
Okay.
But it makes you strong on your own turf. It makes you weak outside. This is a basic thing.
Okay. So what Mr. Raghavendra is saying is that this strategy can yield a lot of results and a lot of profits as well as good results for the Indian producers and Indian filmmakers. But internationally on the critical circuit, it might suffer. So because of this, so it is like a two-way streak. You know, it's just not, it's like a balancing act on both sides. So it might not win many awards, but it might end up making more money. So it's like that.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So the second question comes to us from Aditi. She's asking, is there anything to do with the very form of Hindi cinema which doesn't make it fit into the category of films which compete in the Oscars?
Yeah, that is true. That's what I just said. No,
I think the first question answered.
First question. It is the same
playbook,
thing.
The whole
idea. There's a fundamental grammar. Let's say this much. There's a certain grammar in Indian cinema, which is, I will not go into that, what that grammar is. It is different. For example, if you just take Hollywood, okay. Indian cinema is in the passive voice. Hollywood is in the active voice. Hollywood, to put it, I don't know if you think of grammar. Active voice means Hollywood works on the notion of individual motivation. It's a very key issue in Hollywood. Mm. In Indian cinema, it is karma. It's karmic in some way. That is, things happen to you. Okay, you are the recipient of dispensations of fate, of this destiny. You look at anything, for example, in fact, this came to me when I was watching some movie, Maine Pyar Kiya. Have you seen Maine Pyar Kiya?
Yes.
Suddenly, there is this villain, he's coming along. At this point, the villain is about to stamp the person, this fellow is hanging by a on a cliff with his fingers. And the villain is about to attack this man and kick him over the cliff. Suddenly, a pigeon, which is angry with this fellow because of the past act, that pigeon comes along and attacks this villain and the villain falls over. Okay. Now, where does this pigeon come from? Okay. It's a way of avoiding this entire business of individual motivation that finally there is something else in the past which you have done which will come and affect you. Okay.
Okay.
The same thing. This is the sort of a standard motivational thing in Indian cinema.
I've never thought about movies like this because if you see, I mean, you are right. But Indian movies, for example, okay, so what you are saying is that when you say individual motivations are very important in Western cinema,
in American cinema.
Let's look at
slightly
a movie.
Variations of that in every other cinema.
So let's look at a Western film like Wall Street or Oliver Stone, right?
Yeah.
Michael Douglas and Charlie Sheen.
Yeah.
So there is the the individual motivation of Charlie Sheen to be the best broker under Gordon Gekko, played by Michael Douglas. So okay. His personal journey goes in, and he suffers, and he ultimately gives in to the police, and then he comes back, saves his father, blah blah. So that's his personal journey. So just give me an example how a hero's journey would be in Indian.
I'll give you an example not from cinema but from the epics, right?
Okay.
Now, what is in the Ramayana the motivating thing for Dasharatha to send Rama away? Who is responsible? Answer the question. Who is responsible? Kaikeyi? No. Thought is put into Kaikeyi's head by Mantara, right? Okay. Similarly, in Mahabharata, thoughts are put into the Kaurava's heads by Shakuni, right?
Okay.
And Shakuni is not a person with agency. He himself owes that to some past life, something else, right? So the question is that finally, that thing of responsibility is displaced backwards and backwards and backwards. Okay. Let us take what is the reason for Devdas being what he is? The fact that he's rejected by his father?
But love for Paro largely?
No. His failure. His failure he owes to his father's beatings. Okay. His strict father. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now the point is, if that strict father is really responsible for making the Devdas what he is, Devdas should, in his mind at least, resolve the issue with his father. Does he resolve the issue with his father? No. The point is that father is just some kind of external motivating device who puts Devdas into some passive frame of mind. It's the same thing with Mere Baap Chor Hai. That is never resolved. That Mere Baap Chor Hai is something which has happened to him, which makes him what he is.
So because it's the Baap Chor Hai, he also becomes...
No, it's not even chore. Okay, it is just humiliation. Achha. That society has done something. It is not that he becomes a chore. Let us accept certain things. Vijay in Deewar is not a bad man. He's not even an anti-hero in that sense. Mm. He's actually an admirable person in many ways. He doesn't do anything bad. Mm. Okay, there is no... In fact, if you ask me, the person who does any real bad in Deewar is Shashi Kapoor, is the brother. He shoots that boy for stealing a loaf of bread. Right? He does that. Vijay doesn't do anything bad. But the point is this. Even that there are some extenuating circumstances. He is not a bad man. He is not a thief. He is a victim of circumstances.
So Indian heroes, according to you, will be victim of their circumstances?
Not necessarily. They'll be created by circumstances, not necessarily victims.
So they won't own their world.
Yeah, they're not responsible. They don't own up to their moral, everything, including your...
There is a very interesting new actor who has been doing various kinds of cinema, Ayushman Khurrana. Hmm. Now, what Khurrana does is, all his movies, he's the loser. He's the guy who loses the plot. He's the guy who is having sperm problems. He's the guy who's having, he's working in a call center as a woman, voicing out like a guy who imitates women for a living. So he is usually in these low, and what you are saying, he just literally institutionalizes that kind of hero. But tell me something, when you look at the male protagonist of Hindi cinema, which comes out like a Salman Khan, the guy, the dabang guy, but he owns his world. He does whatever he wants. He thinks is right. And he has his own journey. What do you think of that?
Okay, let me give you an example from Sholay, right?
Okay.
Okay. In Sholay, Gabbar is the villain.
Yes.
These guys are bounty hunters.
Yeah.
Supposed to, what does the bounty hunter do in for a few dollars more? He's supposed to go and catch the villain, kill him,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, okay. For money, yeah.
He has to act. In Sholay, let me ask you, how do they come in contact with Gabbar for the first time? Gabbar comes to the village. His men come to the village. So the question is, these people are reacting to Gabbar. Okay, and Gabbar himself is not an individual. Okay, let's understand this. Gabbar is a combination of one earthquake, two floods. Earlier in Hindi cinema, you used to have, you know, these floods and earthquakes, right?
That was all over.
The point is, instead of having one flood, two earthquakes, one fire, one something else, right? What they do is they replace all of them with one villain. Ajit is that kind of villain.
Okay.
So there is no underlying logic.
So something like Joker in the Batman pantheon, who's basically this all-powerful villain who comes from nowhere like an anarchist and he just disrupts the city of Gotham, where full control has been exercised by various characters.
Yeah.
So in many ways, you would say that the spin of Bollywood is with its villains. The quality of its villains as well, right?
Yeah, the villains have disappeared altogether now. There are no more any villains in Hindi cinema. Where are the villains?
That's quite a statement.
Yeah, I mean, almost no villains. Where are the villains in Hindi cinema? Villains were necessary at a certain social point in cinema. I would say 60s onwards, 70s onwards. Villains represented something. I won't go into that. It's a little complicated. Yeah. I won't go into that. Now that thing of the villain is no longer necessary. Now, what is the villain now? Like, for example, basically, what is the villain? The villain obstructs the path of the hero. Protagonist, right? Places obstructions in the path of the protagonist. Then it was necessary to have these obstructions, right? Nowadays, what is obstruction in what? Obstruction in justice, obstruction in humanitarian thing, obstruction in love, that would be the fundamental thing. Now the question is, after all these obstructions were in somehow, shall we say, in tandem with your Nehruvian socialism. It was at that time, once Nehruvian socialism disappeared as an ideology in India, obstructions also disappeared. Where are their obstructions? Films after, in fact, if anything at all, obstruction in something like Bunty or Bubbly, or you take Guru, take the films, the obstructions are the parents because of the traditional mindset. They want them to go into government employment, right? Bunty or Bubbly also same thing, Guru also same thing. So they are not villains anymore, okay? They are old thinking, whereas it's very different from the villain of Gabbar or Ajit, right? They're not the same kind of villains at all. Here they're just, I mean, the nature of the obstructions have changed. They're no longer villains. But that obstruction is necessary in some sense. They are not those, they're not a combination of three earthquakes and two floods, right?
Okay, so our next question comes from Jitesh Jain from Punjab. He's one of our regular listeners. And he says, why Indian filmmakers who are NRIs get more attention like Meera Nair and Deepa Mehta?
Yeah.
While Indian filmmakers based in India don't get attention. So essentially what he's saying is Indian content creators who are based outside India creating Indian content will get a lot of attention.
There are not so many of them actually.
Why is that?
Okay, let me ask you a question. Have you seen that TV series called Delhi Crime or New Delhi Crime? Delhi Crime.
Delhi Crime, yeah, I've seen it. Yeah.
In my opinion, it's the best Indian TV series I've seen.
Okay.
Yeah. Why is it so good?
Yeah.
Why is it so good? It's got foreign technicians. They know how to edit. Yeah. So the question is, when you use a foreign cinematographer in some way and all your work is... Look, African cinema, I don't know if you're aware of African cinema.
Very less.
Okay, when Usman Sembene was making movies, were very crude. I mean, they were very important. I was in some jury of some African film festival in Zanzibar. Now what is happening is, the script is written by the African student. He's studying in Paris or some such thing. He writes a script, he wants to make a movie. Cameraman comes along, the music person comes along, editor comes along, all of them come and they make a movie with this director there, standing there as the filmmaker. All these other people are there. See, basically, cinema is a collaborative effort. If 80% of your collaborators are foreign, there will be foreign value in your films. You agree with that? Okay. This is very important. Okay. It's very different making a film completely with an Indian crew. Perhaps one cinematographer or so. But increasingly, I mean, if you want to succeed, there is a basic, a cinematographer who comes from France or from America to India, his eye about India will also be different.
Yeah, I agree.
It's of interest is also different.
But sir, the question is, why they get more attention? Like Meera Nair and Deepa Mehta.
I think, I'll say that this much, that Meera Nair, not so much Deepa Mehta, Meera Nair's quality of her filmmaking is, she's made Western films, right? Okay, were you aware of this man called Krishna Shah, who made a movie called Shalimar?
No, I know the movie Shalimar, of course.
Shalimar, okay. He made an American movie, which is completely different from Shalimar. Shalimar, he thought he was going to make an Indian movie. He made a complete flop. He made a hash of the whole thing. But he also made an American film about some relationships and all that, which is indistinguishable from American cinema. But the point is, what kind of scriptwriter, what kind of thing are you going to work with? Deepa Mehta, more than Deepa Mehta, I think Meera Nair has got Western, you know, Western technicians helping her. She's situated abroad. So she's also, one of the things about India that people have, okay, advantage that Indians have, okay, is you've got a milieu like unlike any other in the world, okay. It's grimy. It's extremely grimy. Anurag Kashyap has discovered this, the grime in Anurag Kashyap's movies is unheard of or unseen in nowadays. Stuff like Titli, the stuff like Masan have all started coming, and they've become grimy as a kind of quality. But I see them as actually grimy, as children.
Just to give a heads up to my audience, what crimey basically means is set in the world of crime.
No. It's not that. I mean, it's dirty. Yeah. I mean, you find slums, you find squalor, you find filth, you find rapes happening, you find the dead bodies lying around. I mean, grime is dirty. Okay. Grime.
I thought crime.
It's like Slumdog Millionaire. See, Slumdog Millionaire showcased India's grime, right? It's not even truthful about India. That's a different matter. But the point is, it showcased Indian grime, and because it did that, it managed to get a lot of attention for itself. But it's not an Indian movie. It's a movie made abroad, made in America with American,
totally,
right?
It's totally.
Yeah, correct.
But they just had Lavleen Tandon, who was the Indian director. I mean, the local collaborator, maybe line director, producer. She's a co-producer, co-director actually, as per the credits. But it is largely, the only thing Indian was the book, I think, which was by Vikas Swarup.
Yeah, I don't think that had much to do with the book, yeah.
Well, the book was at least put the whole thing into perspective.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, but then Simon Beaufoy, Danny Boyle, Fox Searchlight, Pathé, these are all global studios who
yeah.
produced it.
Yeah. Great. So the point is that a Western look at India is bound to be successful. An Indian look at India does not look at what the Western looks at. Okay. It's itself is different. Okay. And it doesn't know. See, for example, you take Anurag Kashyap, you take something like Gangs of Wasseypur. Okay. In Gangs of Wasseypur, grandfather and grandson, 50 years apart, meet the same man, okay, who has only hair graying in the temples. Right?
Yeah.
50 years apart. The grandfather is killed by that man. The grandson takes revenge and kills that man in the same hotel. What happens in 50 years in India? Cities are unrecognizable. People are unrecognizable. You can't have a carrier memory for 50 years like that. Just look at Godfather 2, right? Godfather 2, what is that man whom Vito Corleone kills when he goes back to Corleone, right? He kills that man is forgotten altogether, right? He doesn't remember. He's not killing the same man. He's killing somebody else. He's killing an old man. He's forgotten everything. He has no mind. He's senile. Here, 50 years later, that man has just got gray hair on his temples. Okay. This is a certain Indian way of seeing it, because you think that man will remain the same regardless of how old he goes. Okay.
Okay. So what I'm trying to put forward now to our audience is that what MK sir is, Mr. Raghavendra is trying to put forward here is that he's saying that there is an Indian playbook, there is an Indian system of executing stories, characters, narrative, the overall character arch or the director's journey or whatever you want to call it, is very much suited for the Indian audience. And that is also the reason it draws its strength of being not influenced too much by Hollywood's presence in India, still builds the stardom for Indian stars. And what MK sir is talking is purely from the perspective of a movie scholar, a movie critic, and the person who's looking at the evolution of how content is executed. Yeah. Of course, there is a set of different factors which affect is who is the, you know, he also spoke about the fact that global projects with global talent as a cinematographer, writers, producers is very different. And the content produced by Indian people, and Indian crew is also very different. Although Indian films have really done well, as in, despite all these minuses, we have a Mother India and a Salaam Bombay and a Lagan, which have gone as Indian production houses being.
Lagan, just 1 minute. Lagan,
yes.
One of the key things of Lagan is the notion of duration. I don't know if you're familiar with this notion of duration. You're a full film student. Duration is the time taken between the one event and another, the total length of the action in the film in terms of narrative time, right?
Okay.
Now, if you take Sholay, what is the duration in Sholay? Do you know?
2.5 hours.
Nobody knows. You can't tell. Okay. You can't tell how long that the action in the film is set over, right? I saw one movie called Saudagar by
Sushant.
No way of saying. It begins with the two children and it ends with their grandchildren being older than they are. So it must be some 70, 80 years. I really don't know. Lagan you take. What is the duration in Lagan? 3 months.
Yep. Yes.
Which is the time taken for that, for the challenge to be, the match to take place.
So what you are saying is that Lagan's execution was far better than...
Grammatically, it was grammatically Western in many ways.
Okay.
You get me? Okay.
So what Mr. Raghavendra is saying, dear audience, is that ki film ki jo Lagan film thi, uske andar jo duration thi film ke andar. Duration dekhiye, yaad rakhiye, duration is not... essentially the duration of the film, duration of the plot in the story, basically ki ek cheez shuru hoke kab khatam hoti hai, jo cheez shuru hoti hai film mein task hero heroine ke liye ya pure group ke liye, wo khatam ho jati hai 3 mahine mein within the film. Otherwise Indian films tend to have very unexplained durations of their stories within the movie, and that is where
we never know what is the duration actually.
And yeah, that's what Mr. Raghavendra said, that
one of the things
Western that way is because it executed the entire story in a very, very different form, and it had a different grammar because the entire story takes place within 3 months.
Yeah. Okay. This will help. This will help the kind of, there are various other things, like for example, stuff about character subjectivity, things as seen by the character and not as they happened. That's also important.
Would you rate Lunchbox as a premier film which could have gone to the Oscars?
It could have, but there I think Lunchbox is all right. It could have. I think I would say that that's one of the most more Western kind of things. But where it would, does not score is its subject matter is not strong enough.
Oh.
It's not strong enough in the sense that it has to bring in some social thing of some sort, you know. It needs more density of some sort. Yeah,
what Mr. Raghavendra is saying, just a second, sir, is that देखिए कोई भी एक film को एक बड़ा issue attack करना है, एक बहुत major social societal issue को पकड़ना है. Lunchbox, which looks like a great film, by the way, a lot of my friends in New York, Mr. Raghavendra, have seen Lunchbox and Life of Pi. All of them have seen, whether they watch Indian cinema or not, because it is a great story of a man and woman communicating through a lunchbox. But the point is, it's not an issue which is big enough.
Yeah, it's not strong enough emotionally also.
Issues,
so you have to, any festival would require that. You have to have comments on class structure. You have to have comments on gender issues. You have to bring in all these things, or some kind of thing you have to bring in. Okay. That Lunchbox doesn't have. Okay. So its slightness in terms of subject matter is what hampered it. But it's certainly more, again, there is duration. Okay. There is duration. It would be widely acceptable to Western audiences, I would say.
That's also very interesting thing what he has said, is the duration of the way the story and the plot continues within the movie has to be acceptable to a global audience. Yeah. They won't find logic in these senseless durations of multi-generations.
Yeah.
Like Mr. Raghavendra gave the example of Gangs of Wasseypur, wherein, Sardar Khan's father, who's played by Jaideep Ahlawat, who's now becoming a big actor himself. Jaideep Ahlawat dies, then his son comes in, Manoj Bajpayee, then his son comes in, Nawazuddin Siddiqui. But the arch nemesis of all these three is the same man, Ramadhir Singh.
Yeah.
And he doesn't grow that old, but we have 3 generations of a family facing the similar enemy. So although it might look very good to the audience as a very stylish, swag-driven story.
You're talking about revenge. So you're talking about, you know, that thing of revenge.
Yes.
But 50 years later, the same man remains the same. He's the same person.
Yeah.
No, these are all issues, right? These are all big
Great, great.
issues.
So we have a final question.
I'll say this much, you know, I'm fairly confident that I know how to write a script acceptable to the West.
Okay.
But the point is that may not be acceptable within India. Okay. But the point is whether it will be commercially successful is different.
Fantastic.
But it can be successful in terms of its appeal at festivals, appeal to international juries. It can be more successful. It can be done. It's not, but I don't think people have paid attention. I don't think our film schools have paid attention. Okay.
We don't have any film schools to
talk. I know. I don't think there are any. I don't think they're worth talking about.
Today, the only private film schools we know of or have heard of, like I went to a film school in Los Angeles and studied there for 2 years, worked there for 2 years in Hollywood. Then I got to know more about how cinema is produced and directed. Like in India, what I've seen is cinema is an art form. Okay. And it's a business as well. In the West, it is an art form. It is a business, but more importantly, it is a science also. So science means that they will take literature through a book, they will acquire the rights, then they will develop the project, then they will find an actor, then they will find 200 countries to release it now on different platforms. So I saw this very differently. And in Indian cinema, Indian film school, there is just Whistling Woods in Bombay, which opened up by Subhash Ghai, which has got some traction now.
They will simply move teachers from this school to that school, right? It's like this. When you bring in foreign universities into India, okay, you're not going to get foreign teachers. You're going to move people from the existing universities to foreign universities. Is what they're going to do.
So what you are saying is just the certificate is going to come out rather than...
come out of that, yeah, that kind of thing. But basically, they're moving the same faculty. This is what they do. Now, let me say one more thing. What is that? If you want to study cinema, okay, don't go to the US like you went. Go to Russia. Okay? In Russia, the great filmmakers became teachers. In America, the failed filmmakers became teachers. Okay?
There's a big difference.
Okay. I would not want to learn filmmaking in America at all. Okay.
Sir, you have
I would probably send them to Russia. Okay. Tarkovsky taught. All of them taught. All the big guys and the great filmmakers, which is why a new entrant. I don't know, have you seen this guy who this chap who made this movie called Beanpole? Have you seen Beanpole, Russian film?
No.
You should see this guy. I think.
See, the only Russians. See, now Russian cinema, viewers, एक बहुत ही interesting country है cinema के point of view से, क्योंकि उन्होंने पहली बड़ी film बनाई थी किसी भी scale के लिए, called Battleship Potemkin in 1926. We are talking about some 100 years old ago. They built the first magnum opus. They made Solaris, Andrei Tarkovsky's. They made Andrei Rublev. They made all these big budget films. And Russians, and the last film which was actually referred to me by Raghavendra sir was a movie called Cargo 200 by Alexei Babylonov, which I thoroughly enjoyed. And so Russia is also having a language. And now let's come back to our discussion, sir. We have a last question from our audience. Now this is coming from another friend of mine, Aniruddha. He says that the movies like Court and Tithi and now The Disciple, are these the way forward for India at the global circuit?
Court and Tithi, yes, not Disciple.
Okay.
Okay, I would rate those two.
Why would you rate them high?
They work. I mean, it's a little difficult to talk about it. Again, they're more mimetic in some sense.
Okay.
In the sense that they are more observant about actual life. Tithi, and I would say that Court and Tithi, I'm impressed by the fact that he picked the same thing. I'm not sure about Disciple. Okay. I just saw it. I don't think the Disciple is the way forward. But Court and Tithi are probably the best movies made in India for the past 20 years, I would say.
So just to sum up what Raghavendra sir said is, mimesis is a science. Mimesis means cinema
imitation.
Basically, right? Correct.
Imitation of the world.
Imitation of
replicating the world in your movie is telling a story, which in many ways is like the world itself, rather than delivering a message. So it is the message is for the interpretation by the critic. It is not intended in that way.
So what you are saying is holding a mirror to the real world.
Correct. You're right.
Okay.
Correct. Perfect. Like you, for example, you take Vertigo. You take Vertigo.
One of my favorite
films. Vertigo. What is the message in Vertigo? It's a very complex thing, right? So the question is, obviously there'll be fiction here, not simply a matter of photographic realism. You'll have to write a story which also is convincing. But the basic thing is, you're basically telling stories which have some resemblance to the real world. This is basically it. And I think Tithi did that. Mm-hmm. And I think Court also did that. Okay, but not Disciple.
Superb.
Disciple doesn't do
that. Just to tell to our viewers, Tithi is a Kannada film, Thithi, Tithi, and which was released a few years ago. In fact, Amir Khan had tweeted about this movie, I remember. And Court is Chaitanya Tamhane's movie made in 2014. It's available, I think, online, was available on Amazon a few months back. Disciple is yet to release in India. Disciple is Chaitanya Tamhane's next movie, which is produced along with his mentor, Alfonso Cuarón. It's actually the first Indian independent film which has been repped by a big Hollywood agency called William Morris Endeavor, Division Endeavor Content, that is, you know, representing the movie. It has won the Fipreski Award at Venice Film Festival. And again, just to sum up this discussion from Raghavendra sir, and I think sir would agree, is that Indian films follow a certain playbook, a certain set of rules before making itself palatable to Indian audiences in India and abroad. But they have to change their playbook, look at more realism in their treatment. They should attack bigger issues and have a tightly knit script and look at the qualitative aspects of storytelling, such as duration, etc., of the story itself, as you know, the reasons if they want to move forward. But anyways, thank you so much, Raghavendra sir, coming all the way to us from Bangalore. I hope you stay fit and fine in this, telling times. And we would be reaching out to you. And just a little introduction. Filmi Baniya is an online community of movie lovers, TV lovers, content lovers. We have featured some A-list Hollywood writers, filmmakers, and we are available on Facebook and YouTube. Please do subscribe to our YouTube channel, Filmi Baniya, FilmiBaniya. And please give your good wishes and keep guiding us in the coming days. And many thanks for spending time with me and the Filmi Baniya community. Thank you so much, sir. And it is always a pleasure and, to always get your point of view. And this is really great. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. My pleasure.